Yes, I know that you're mad at me. But what I'm hoping is that by the time we get to the end of this concert, you'll understand why one time in our history we would move Messiah to Easter, and you're all meant to come back, by the way, so that we could make way just once for different music here at Christmas time. And it is wonderful to see so many people. I was worried it would be two people and their dog just to punish me for having messed around with your tradition. But it's great to see such a great crowd. And maybe if you have read my program notes, you would understand why in this, my 10th season, when Adrian and the Music Worcester Board have seen fit to let me do anything that I want, why I might open a concert with the magnificent Susan Consoli, soprano, and with John on trumpet. These guys are just fantastic. So much of my career when I lived in Australia, in fact, oddly enough, I moved back from Sydney exactly 10 years ago this weekend. Much of that time was taken up with a project that was probably so exciting that I will never again be able to do something quite so large scale, which was to perform all of Bach's cantatas. There are all of the ones that involve choir rules. And so there are about 140 of those out of a total of about 200, though many are lost. These are just incredibly important works in the choral repertoire, but so many of them simply go unperformed because there are so many of them. And so in this concert, which is a chance to look back over our 10 years together, I wanted to just highlight a couple of them. Have heard one. And now we're going to look at BWV 1, just a quick story. So this section, by the way, which is listed in your program as Deciphering Bach, you'll see in a second what that means. We're going to pick apart a movement so you can hear a little bit about what Bach's own audiences, what his congregation would have taken for granted, but it's arcane knowledge that has since sort of been lost and only discovered in the last couple decades. Bach, this is sort of impossible to get your mind around. A cantata is about 20 to 25 minutes long, and the one that you're about to hear is a perfect example of it. It's built around a chorale or a hymn. You're going to hear that in a moment. And there are usually two choral pieces at the beginning, a fancy one with a big orchestral accompaniment, and then at the end, that hymn presented simply. You're going to hear that tonight. And then in the middle, there are usually two pairs of a recitative, which is sort of as close to spoken singing as you can get, plus an aria. There are two of those pairs. So tonight is a perfect example of that. So this guy, imagine raising 21 children, and on top of that, writing a cantata every single week. And then, because you didn't have printers of any kind for music, you had to then write it out by hand so that all the orchestral players would have their parts and all the singers would have their parts. It is a gargantuan feat that I still, even after having performed, I did 80 of those cantatas and then moved back here so I could conduct these guys. And my successor finished that project with all the cantatas. Even after having done so many, I still can't get my head around what that would have meant. So, wie schön leuchtet der Morgenstern, how brightly shines the morning star. And I chose one of the cantatas that is based on a chorale that we know. So many of these chorales, I know we've got lots of Lutherans there and up here, and I love having them around because they know more of those old Bach chorales. But for those of us who come from other traditions, not many of those chorales have remained so important. But this chorale is a very famous Christmas one. I just want you to hear our sopranos sing through the first half of the chorale, just to remind you.
Recognize that immediately as a Christmas chorale. Now what's interesting is that this
cantata, which celebrates the Annunciation when the angel Gabriel came to tell a very young Mary that she was about to have God's baby. That is actually, if we go back 9 months from December 25th, the Feast of the Annunciation is March 25th, but Bach used a Christmas chorale to signal to his congregation that they should think about Christmas. Now, usually that final chorale is pretty basic, not just sopranos, but the whole choir would sing in block chords as they go along, and the orchestra would double them. But as Jeff is about to show us, Bach signals something else in this version, and there are not many chorale settings where he plays around like this. I think it's really quite amazing. The Annunciation, the angel Gabriel, who has his trumpet, Gabriel's trumpet, Bach implants that trumpet in the middle of this chorale. So these are not normal trumpets. These are not normal trumpeters, in fact. That is a normal trumpet. And this is a piccolo trumpet, which is what you just saw John playing on, which is a really high range. We are using a flugelhorn, which you'll hear. It's a lovely sound. It might encounter more in jazz than in classical music, because it is in the perfect range for a horn without being overpowered. Because the rope horn did not sound strong as the modern one. So listen to that again, the exact same thing. We hear the soprano singing that chorale tune, and this time we hear Gabriel blowing his trumpet. So if that sounded familiar, that is the pastoral movement from the Christmas oratorio. So by looking at that, we are reminded that 12:8 often means set out in the pasture. And if we had any doubt about that, we have two sets of instruments here to remind us. We're going to begin, can you guys hold your instruments up? So these are our erstwhile oboists, but these are not oboes, these are big oboes. oboes on steroids, basic death metal. 20 seconds of fame is coming to a very good close. This is the modern instrument called the English horn, but in the Baroque period, this would have been what is called the corno di caccia. Caccia in Italian means hunting. So this is the hunting oboe, and it has a much more pastoral sort of timbre to it. You can imagine shepherds out in the field playing these instruments. Listen to their material at the very beginning, and you'll see what I mean. bass line to symbol the rocking of the cradle. So we're going to listen to the cellos and double bass, and this bong, bing, bong, imagine the rocking. So what you're going to hear now is I want to go back to the very beginning. You heard that chorale. The way that Bach often uses the chorale in a movement like this is he has the soprano singing in long notes over the top. It sort of binds everything together. Now this is not true of my sopranos, but just a little inside baseball info. The reason why he moved to Leipzig, where he settled for the final 23 years of his life, the reason the sopranos usually got the cantus firmus is that these were little boys and he didn't trust them. There's a very famous document about him complaining that the admissions office was doing a terrible job of making good, usable, in fact, is the word that he used, usable trebles. These guys sound great. So you're going to hear the opening, and then we'll go back after that, perform the whole cantata. I've left out the rest of the choir, but you'll be able to hear what they do as they pass around.